Hello and welcome to Tar Heel Teachers at Home. I'm Marlo Artis. I'm the moderator of the program. Tar Heel Teachers at Home is an interview series focused on engaging North Carolinians in conversations around education. Each week, I'm happily joined by a wonderful panel of educators, each one representing a particular subsection of education. We'll start our introductions with our elementary school panelists.
Hey, my name is Dusty Martin. I'm the principal at Stories Creek Elementary in Person County. I am in my 13th year in education, and I am currently the principal of the year for Person County Schools.
Awesome. Congratulations. Thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Amy Tart. I teach ELA and social studies for Clay County Schools. I've been teaching for 7 years. You can find me on Twitter at Cards for Scholars.
Hello, my name is Micah Tweetmeyer. I'm a biology teacher at Riverside High School in Durham. This is my 13th year teaching, and you can follow me on Twitter at Micah J. Hunter.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Arisha Smalls. I'm the elementary AIG program specialist for Cumberland County Schools. This is my 14th year in education, and you can follow me on Twitter at Smalls Arisha.
Awesome. We're really excited about this special episode. So last week, Catherine Truitt was elected North Carolina State Superintendent. We're very fortunate that one of her first interviews as the State Superintendent-Elect is here with us on Tar Heel Teachers at Home. Catherine, welcome back to the program.
Thanks so much, Marlo. I'm really thrilled to be here with you on episode 83.
We're really excited to have you, and this is your third time. Congratulations on being named State Superintendent. So, Catherine, take us into last Tuesday, election night. Where were you and how did you find out the results that you were state superintendent? And what have been some of the things that's been going through your mind over the last several days?
Well, I was first at home, and my parents, who are in their 70s, decided to come and visit. To be here with me during the election. So in order to distract myself, we went out to dinner with my husband and my children. And then we went, there was a watch party downtown and we stopped in for 10 minutes and then I came home. I just wanted to be with my family and then the numbers started coming in and I think we knew by around 10:30 or so that it was looking pretty good. And I think that I felt relieved that the campaigning part was over because that's very difficult. It's difficult on candidates' families. I was also working full-time still as chancellor of WGU North Carolina. Mm-hmm. So I felt a sense of relief, but I also, I was very happy, but I didn't feel the sense of, I guess, elation that I thought I might feel. I felt very, it was very humbling. Like it was just sort of washed over me all at once. And it's been since then, I would say it's been a very sobering experience, and I've had a lot of really wonderful conversations with people since then. And I'm already doing work to get ready for January.
That's great, and it is very humbling, especially when you think about this fact, Catherine, that you are the second woman in 167 years to serve in this role. And this year, 2020. We actually had two women on the ballot for state superintendent. That's never happened before. So what does that all mean to you, the magnitude of that?
I think, you know, June Atkinson was, I remember the first time that I met her. I was just, she was my superintendent when I was still teaching in Johnston County, my state superintendent. And I just remember feeling so, you know, I'm not worthy when I met her. And I've just been such a fan of hers for a long time. And so I think I was really, I was also the only Republican woman on the Council of State slate. So I think the Democrats had a couple of women, but so that was never lost on me throughout, throughout the campaign season. But the fact that I'm standing on the shoulders of giants has never been lost on me at all. My grandmother was a teacher. My grandfather was a teacher. My father was a teacher. My father's been teaching music for 54 years, and it just meant so much for me to have him. I mean, he's still not retired. So yeah, it was a very moving evening.
That's wonderful. And before I turn it over to the co-host, Catherine, so as you think about these next 50 plus days, what are you doing to get prepared to take on this humbling experience, this humbling role, this momentous role? What are your next steps as you prepare to transition to being our next state superintendent?
Both the board and I have talked, have been talking since the day after the election about the importance of a smooth transition and the need for healing between the Office of Superintendent and the state board. We want this to be a very smooth transition, especially because we enter a long session just a couple of weeks after I will be sworn in. And there is a lot at stake. And everyone on this call knows that there is a lot at stake. I think that the board and I are very much aligned in our view of what a smooth transition will look like. And there are roles at DPI that have been empty for a while. But really, you know, I am not interested in just filling positions. I want to build a team. And that is where I'm spending my energy right now.
That's great. That's very wise. What questions do we have for Catherine Truitt, State Superintendent-Elect of the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction?
I'll start, Marlo. I feel like you've touched on it a little bit so far as you've been kind of opening up the show. But during the campaign, a candidate speaks often about what they want to do or what they will do once they win the seat, right? But you've won now. So where can we expect to see you focusing your efforts as you begin your journey as superintendent, state superintendent?
The very first thing that I want to do is to not just align my, so let me rephrase. I want to think about 4 years from now, you know, what do we want to have all said that we did? Where do we want to be in 4 years? I'm a backwards design Grant Wiggins kind of teacher, and I want to start with the end in mind. One thing that I do know, and the board and the legislature want to do this as well, there's been a lot of attention paid for the last year on early literacy instruction. And even the UNC system is starting an early reading initiative. And this is something that we cannot afford to get wrong. And so the board over the summer came out with its final definition of what high quality literacy instruction looks like. We've got changes that need to be made to the Read to Achieve legislation to reflect that work, and that work needs to come before third grade. It needs to start in pre-K, and for those children who don't attend pre-K, it needs to be a K-2 initiative because third grade's too late. So the first thing that I want to do is talk about the possibility, and I did mention this during the campaign, I would love to do something similar to what Mississippi did, which is launch a statewide initiative that involves not just schools, but also parents around the importance of early literacy instruction and reading.
Well, I am so glad that you began talking about early literacy, because the two other times that you've been on our show, in January, I asked you that, and in June, I asked you that. And so every 4 to 5 months, I get an answer. So in about March or April, when you're back on our show, I'm going to ask you again, and then we're going to see what kind of progress we've made.
I love it, Arisha. That's perfect. That's perfect. Keep me accountable.
All right, so I've got a question then. So one of the things that you mentioned in your campaign was this need to overhaul accountability and testing system that we currently have, mm-hmm. and looking at trying to be more student-centered and meaningful for all stakeholders. Mm-hmm. So how do you foresee that process, that transition playing out during your tenure as state superintendent?
So fortunately, I think there's a lot of appetite to change that. I think there are very few people in our state that want to keep the school accountability system as it is. And I actually just received a report today. I have not had a chance to read it, but it's an SREB report on how what their recommendations are specific to North Carolina to make our school accountability system, all of those things that you just said, Dusty. It's more student-centered. It's useful to teachers. It's not punitive, and it is... helps inform instruction, uses data to inform instruction. Lots of states have managed to do this, and they've done a better job than we have. So I think there's a couple of different things that need to happen that involve school accountability. So first, there's just the testing process. I don't want to remove accountability from schools, because we all know that what gets measured gets taught. However, I'm not a fan of the high stakes testing that is punitive for either children or teachers or school leaders. And so I would like to see, this year certainly, we have to look at assessments as diagnostic, because we have to have some tools so that teachers and parents know where children are. I mean, I'm facing this with my own children right now, not my older ones, but my younger one. And I think that for me as an educator, growth is actually more important to me than achievement. And it is, I mean, I'm with teachers when they say, you know, it's not right that a teacher, let's say an eighth grade teacher, inherits a class that is X amount of years behind. Yes, it's possible to grow them, but of course they're not going to make up for 7 years of lost learning or 4 years of lost learning, whatever it is. And there are a lot of factors that are beyond teachers' control. And so I think that a good place to start, although I'm certainly not wedded to this, is at the very least, looking at growth and accountability as two different measurements. I don't see the need to have to weight them and combine them into a grade. I also don't like letter grades. And I think I may have said this before on this program, I'm not sure, but you know, I lead a 100% competency-based university right now. I'm not a fan of letter grades. I would, in 4 years, I would love to see us fall down the path to competency-based education, because I feel like that is the ultimate in instructional equity.
So you spoke a little bit about testing. So what are your thoughts of the current system of, you know, teacher raises based on student performance on those tests? Do you think that initiative should continue, or would you want to revamp it in any sort of way?
Yeah, you know, philosophically, I don't have a problem with merit-based pay, but I don't know that achievement is, I don't think that testing scores are the way to determine merit, if that makes sense. So I like the idea of, I mean, when I taught in England, I did receive a bonus 1 year because of the growth that I brought for my students. And it was completely secret, for lack of a better word. There are certain jobs where bonuses are confidential. That's the word I'm looking for. So merit pay was confidential. And so there wasn't, there wasn't any sense of lack of community, from merit pay. But I understand the divide between teachers of whether or not merit pay is something that people want to consider. I kind of feel like the bonuses that we're offering for, I think it's career technical education, I always think that there are unintended consequences of paying those kinds of bonuses. Other people have told me that I'm wrong. I'm sure I'll learn more about that in the next several months. But I am interested, I love the idea of paying teachers more for advanced teaching roles, for classifying teachers in ways that have to do not just with years of experience, but with their willingness to, we all have seasons in our lives when we can take on more responsibility and times when we can't. And so I like the idea of expanding advanced teacher roles and providing more pay that way, or for having teachers who want to work 12 months a year and earning more money that way. But to put a point on your actual question, I don't know that achievement alone is something that I would think about for pay.
One of the last times you were here, we talked about the possibility of an equity office within DPI. And during that time, you said possibly for an internal equity office, but you didn't want an equity office just for the sake of an equity office. And right now, as we have the Leandro report waiting to be enacted, and we're in a pandemic where we see the inequities magnified, have you possibly changed your mind about the importance of developing an equity office for DPI?
I think that an equity office that is specific, whose job is to work to enact Leandro, is wholly appropriate. And we do have one. There is an executive director of Leandro under the state board. And there is, it's actually dual reporting right now. I think what I would caution folks against in terms of a standalone office of equity at DPI is that I don't think that a standalone office of equity that has to do with ensuring that districts are doing X, Y, and Z. I don't like the idea of a top-down approach when the department has no regulatory authority over local superintendents. And so I think there are other ways for me to advocate for equity. And I think that that's the beauty of the West End report, is that it's the law now that we have to ensure equity. And the West Ed report and the State Board of Education and the judge actually do provide some regulatory authority to ensure that we achieve equity the way that the report lays out.
So today, Catherine, a report came out from the General Assembly Program Evaluation Division related to a lack of statewide efforts around teacher diversity, increasing teacher diversity in our state. So under your leadership, how do you imagine that DPI can help to increase the diversity of teachers here in North Carolina?
Yeah, that. So I've not had a chance to read that report yet, but I did know that it came out. I actually talked to Jeff Coltrane this morning about this report. So one way that has been suggested to North Carolina that I've actually been working on in my role at WGU is to leverage teacher assistants in our districts to return to college and become licensed teachers, because they're already a part of the community in which they live, and they will stay in those districts and support the students in the community. And we're doing that with last dollar scholarships that allow, because our programs are asynchronous, they allow TAs to continue to work full-time in their role as a TA. So the district's not losing out on valuable TAs. And most TAs qualify for Pell, unfortunately. And so they cannot afford to quit their job and go back to school full-time. So we have to, I think one of the best things that we can do is not just think outside the box in terms of how do we help our TAs return to school to keep a pipeline of diverse teachers, of diverse teaching filled, but also our community colleges have recently staggered. I'm not sure if all of them have launched it, but I know all of them plan to, an AAAS in teacher prep. And so this is going to allow us to create pathways that start in high school and allow for students to be recruited and have a low cost option of working their way through to get that teaching degree. But it absolutely must be a priority. Our students must be able to see themselves in their education journey.
Mm-hmm. And one of the suggestions in the report was about expanding teaching fellows to mm-hmm. HBCUs and minority serving institutions, because the previous teaching fellows, the program was at Central, A&T, and UNC Pembroke. Are you in support of us expanding in that way?
I'm in favor of any expansion that maintains the high standards of that amazing program. I think, and I think it's wholly appropriate to expand them to HBCUs as a way to ensure that we have more teachers of color entering the profession.
Mm-hmm. And another thing I wanted to share too, Catherine, a couple of weeks ago here on the program, we had Dr. Camille Goins and Dr. Leslie Locklear from UNC Pembroke. And we were talking about the fall program and the FAPE program increasing the number of American Indian teachers and administrators. And one of the areas of concern that we discussed on that episode was that DPI, whenever we're categorizing school demographics and we're looking at DPI's website, we will see that the number of Black teachers that we have, the number of white teachers, and then we move into the other category. And so we don't necessarily know as a state how many American Indian teachers we have, how many Latinx teachers. Is that something that you think we could get some progress in terms of really quantifying those numbers across the state and by district?
Is it, so Marlo, is it because the N size is too small? Is that why they're not reporting it?
I'm not sure. I do intend to reach out to Tom Tomerlin about it. But I just, when I look at that report and I go by district, I got Black, white, and other. And in 2020, you know, that's very problematic when we can't even tell how many we have per district for those various categories.
I totally agree with you. There has to be a way to define those numbers. And it's the same thing, you know, when we look at our NAEP scores, we see Black, white, and then Native American or American Indian, Pacific Islander, or other all lumped in together. And I think that when we're talking about data for official purposes, it's problematic because the number, to your point, is actually so small. So unfortunately, it's going to be a small number, which is why we need these programs. And it's the same issue when we look at our test scores. But surely there can be a way mm-hmm. to find out what those exact numbers are
and report them.
Yes, exactly.
You were talking about wanting that smooth transition and knowing that there needs to be some healing between the State Board of Ed and the State Superintendent's Office. there's possibly some healing that needs to be done between educators and the state superintendent's office. So what's your plan for that?
Right now, I am in the process of creating a job description for someone whose sole job will be to do community outreach in school buildings and with teachers and school leaders. I think that there has to be a better feedback loop for educators and building leaders. You know, the feedback loops are already there with superintendents, but we don't necessarily have them for teachers and principals. I think one of the biggest problems that we need to solve for is not learning about the unintended consequences of policies and legislation after the fact. And the only way that we're going to solve for that is for this feedback loop to be created, invested in, and maintained. And if we do that right, then we won't have teachers and administrators feeling like things are being done to them. I would love for there to be some kind of, I don't know if it would be called professional development, but I really like the idea of sharing with teachers in some sort of train the trainer model, maybe some way that, you know, there could be district representation and teachers could then take this information back to their colleagues. But I would love for all teachers to have a better understanding of the legislative process and understand the good, the bad, and the ugly of how education legislation is passed and what happens on Jones Street. I mean, I didn't know any of that when I was teaching in Johnston County. I knew we had a state superintendent. I knew her name was June Atkinson. I would get emails from her. I knew who my superintendent was. And that was about it. And I can tell you from, I know this is a very well-informed group, but I know from being on the campaign trail that a lot of teachers and parents are kind of in the dark when it comes to how these things happen, how, you know, a legislator gets an itch, and then all of a sudden there's an unfunded mandate. You know, how does that happen? And I think that understanding what the State Board of Education does and how and what the purpose of the, I mean, at the end of the day, the state superintendent's job is to run the Department of Public Instruction. And it just so happens that there's all these other things that go along with it and opportunities to advocate and to use a bully pulpit and all of those things. But I think the efficacy of a state superintendent is her ability to figure out how to communicate with everyone who's involved in education. And that is something that I am already thinking about, I promise you.
So one of the things that I feel like you've kind of said throughout your campaign is you feel like our system is broken and mm-hmm. we've got to really reimagine how funding happens in our state. Mm-hmm. So as you're working with the state board, what would be your major priorities in terms of funding for us as a state?
Yeah, so when I say that things are broken, I am talking about funding, I'm talking about our HR system, and I'm talking about our accountability system. We don't have time to talk about the testing, but back to your earlier question, Dusty, I think we should be giving nationally normed tests instead of EOGs and EOCs, and that it should be just one snapshot of what's going on in a student's life. As far as funding goes, I think that our, you know, our, the 60, 2% of funding that comes from the state is actually equitable in that it doesn't matter what your zip code is, your base funding is the same. That doesn't mean that all students are getting what they need. So the most inequitable type of funding that we have is the 27% that comes from the county, because that is based on a county's tax rate. And so that is a case of the rich getting richer and the poor getting poorer. I also would submit to you that because we fund positions, teaching positions through allotment, that if you are a principal on this side of town and you're doing, you know, you've got wealthier kids and you've got great test scores, teachers are going to opt to come to you first by and large, rather than the school in the same district across town. And so because we fund teachers such that you can hire that teacher regardless of how much they're going to cost you based on whether or not they get master's pay or have more experience, the teacher, that's great for you, but the principal over here is not getting those teachers because of teacher sorting, of self-selection. And so you've got $5 million worth of teachers and this principal has $3 million worth of teachers, and that's not equitable. And that is not a popular position to take, but I think it's something that we need to talk about. Because I think that you know, it sounds good to a principal to say, I can hire any teacher I want, regardless of how much he or she costs, but are you really getting the teachers that you want and need? You know, a third of students in North Carolina don't have a fully licensed math teacher. How can we ensure that principals who really need a good math teacher get someone who is fully licensed and not just a warm body trying to teach advanced math? These are the kinds of things that I think are conversations that are hard, but necessary. I think there's a lot of different conversations being had about how much more funding we need. And I think that we all need to be looking at the same data when we have those conversations. Whatever we land on, wherever we get that data, some groups look and say, well, we're not funded at the national average, so it's not enough. But others are looking at individual district level data and saying, well, we do fund students who are English language learners, students who have an IEP or a 504, and students who are low income, they're being funded at a rate of 33% higher than a student who is not those things. And so how much more do we need? And where should that money go? Because y'all, the data is pretty clear. We haven't moved the needle for our most vulnerable kids, at least since the 90s. So what are we doing wrong? We've had periods where we've spent a lot of money on education and periods where we haven't spent a lot of money on education and nothing has changed. And I think that there needs, you know, I've always said that if I could wave a wand, the very first thing that I would fund at a much higher rate are all of our school support personnel. We know that we are not funding them properly. And we know that they have I think we would tackle a lot of issues, including teacher retention, if we did fund those positions at their recommended ratios.
Mm-hmm. Arisha, did you have a question?
I did, but of course, it is on a totally different track than what we're on right now. But what I wanted to ask was, throughout this interview, when you speak of June Atkinson, it's it's from a place of admiration, and I can tell that you hold her, you know, in high regard. And I guess I'm thinking about the passing of Alex Trebek, and when he was still here with us and in the spotlight, multiple occasions he said he wanted to be spoken of and remembered as a deeply decent man, right? And so you're going to be starting soon, and I guess I want to know, when we speak of you, how would you like for us to regard you when we speak of you? How do you want us, those of us still in education, to speak of your work and the things that you're doing?
I want people to say about me that I did the best I could to keep students at the center and keep the politics at the side. I want to be, you know, somebody said to me this morning, there are two people on the Council of State right now who are kind of considered, not an institution is the wrong word, but just people that the voters trust. One of them is Elaine Marshall and one of them is Steve Troxler. I don't know either one of them personally. I know them by reputation, but I would like to be thought of as someone who follows through, can be trusted, and did what she said she was going to do, which is put students at the center.
And Catherine, I was very happy to hear a few minutes ago when you said you had spoken to Jeff Coltrane, because you served as senior education advisor to Governor McCrory. So how do you imagine that you will be able to work with the governor's office around educational policy and educational issues?
So the governor has already called me. We had a lovely conversation over the weekend. I understand firsthand, well, not firsthand, but once removed, what it's like to govern. And it's very, you know, I think it's a credit to, I only had the chance to serve in that role from the time I joined until the governor lost the election. Jeff has served in this role for 4 years. That's a very long time in governor education land. And governor's education advisors land. And I said that to the governor, that that's a credit to him that Jeff still wants to serve in that role, because usually good people like Jeff do this for a couple of years and then they're off to do something else. And I think that one of the first things that I would love to do would be to invite Senator Berger, Eric Davis, Governor Cooper, and me to sit down and just have a conversation about who we are as people. And, you know, talk about our favorite place in North Carolina, or how we found ourselves where we are today. I would love to be able to see all of those people as people first, and have them see me as a person first.
I think that's a great place for us to end this interview, Catherine. And we certainly appreciate you coming on this program. This is your third visit. And throughout your tenure as state superintendent, we welcome you to come on this program and engage us in dialogue about the progress that your administration is making. And any way that we can support your administration, please don't hesitate to reach out to us, because we want to see you successful in this role. And we certainly want the best for the educators and the students of North Carolina. We know that you want that as well, and we're here to support you.
Thanks, Marlo.
We want to thank our audience so very much for watching this program. We hope that you will engage us on our social media platforms. Please engage us on Twitter. Our handle is @TarHillTeachers. Like our Facebook page, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and all of our social media platforms, please use our #TarHillTeachers so we can find all of your great comments, and visit our website, TarHillTeachers.com. We'd like to thank our wonderful group of panelists for joining us for this conversation, Dusty Martin, Amy Tart, Micah Tweetmeyer, and Arisha Smalls. And once again, we would like to thank our special guest. She is Catherine Truitt, the North Carolina State Superintendent-Elect for the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction. We look forward to seeing you next time on Tar Heel Teachers at Home.